Nasiruddin Memorial Lecture being organized by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. Impact of Sufism on Deccan Society by Professor S.M. Azizuddin Hussain, former Professor of History, Jamia Millia Islamia University, New Delhi. It is my proud privilege to welcome all our guests and invitees for today's program. May I now request the president of today's function and our beloved Vice Chancellor, Professor K. Sitarama Rao Garu, please come on to the dais and occupy the chair. Now I invite Professor S.M. Azizuddin Hussain Ji, former Ed and Professor of History, Jamia Millia Islamia University, New Delhi. He is the today's chief guest to kindly come on to the stage and occupy the chair, sir. Today, Professor S.M. Azizuddin Hussain is going to deliver a lecture on Impact of Sufism on Deccan Society. I also now invite Professor A. Sudhakar Garu, Director Academic, and Professor C. Venkataya Garu, Register of the University. Please come on to the stage and occupy the chair. Now we acknowledge on this August gathering university directors, deans, heads of the branches and office bearers of the various service associations, office bearers and members of Deccan History Society, Hyderabad, and teaching and non-teaching fraternity, and many scholars are present here. Now I request all the dignitaries on the dais kindly proceed for the lighting of the lamp and offer a floral tribute to Professor S. Bashiruddin Garu.
Professor Sudhakar, Director Academic, Professor Venkataya Garu, Registrar, and various participants and dignitaries who have come from different parts of the country to participate in the seminar and also in the memorial lecture program. So this memorial lecture of Professor, late Professor Bashiruddin, every year in the month of February on the occasion of his birthday, this really, in fact, this need to be organized on February 6th. But when we thought of this seminar, organizing the seminar here, we have shifted this program and make this program as part of this seminar. So we thought this would be most useful, and also it will be befitting to the topic which we have selected, and also person whom we have invited to give this memorial lecture. So when it is clubbed with the seminar, international seminar on Iran-Deccan relations during the medieval period, and Sufism also made lot of impact with the culture of Persia and Persians. So that is the reason we have organizing this memorial lecture today as part of this international seminar. So I, one of the person who was very much interested in to know many things about the Sufism. To my little knowledge, Sufism or Sufi cult is like a bhakti movement in Hinduism. It's by and large one and same. See, dargahs, darga culture, and the things take place. I visited many dargahs, and especially Gulbarga, main Darga, and also Kazipet, we have good Darga is there. Like that, I have visited many Dargas and participated in so many functions organized by them. So that since Bhakti movement has great impact on the society, on common man, even now in Dargas, most of the Hindus go and actively take part. And that is the reason why the so much impact of Sufi culture and Sufi saints on the Indian society, especially on the Dakkan culture is also. This is very interesting question we have to probe. And this definitely, this culture of Sufism and this Bhakti cult, even now it is widespread and in deep on the minds and way of life and culture of the people, irrespective of their religions. So that is the reason the Sufism is a, it is like a movement or cult or culture which tried to integrate the people and develop a sort of concern for the poor society and basing on the values of service, love and other issues. So this is the my understanding briefly. I don't know about the details about the Sufi cult and Sufism. That is the reason this time we have selected the topic of impact of Sufism on the Dakkan society. So with this brief introduction, before going to the details of the program and remaining parts of the agenda, since I made a promise, I request Director of Indolog Foundation, Dialogue for Peace, Hyderabad office, Usman Kyaglo, to give his brief message about the seminar and this program.
Dear esteemed Vice Chancellor, sir, and distinguished guests on the dais, and my dear mentor, I can say, Professor Akbar Ali Khansab, thank you so much. This is my honor being here with you on the topic of impact of Sufism in Deccan society. Thanks so much. Actually, I am from Turkey. This is my 6th year in Hyderabad. I'm settled down in Hyderabad. And I enjoy a lot Hyderabadi culture because we have common values. We have the same culture, I can say. But Hyderabad is a little bit spicy. Yes, I have to mention that. But we, I mean, quite the same culture we have between Turkey and Hyderabad, because our 4 ladies came, and the last Khalifa Abdul Majid Efendi's daughter Durrüşşeyh var, and her cousin sister Princess Nülfer, they came. Later on, Princess Esin and Esra, they came, and still they are alive, and then they are trying to make alive the connection between and between Turkey and Hyderabad. But sadly, I have to say that nobody knows this connection in Turkey, including me. When I came to India, I came to know we have a good connection with Hyderabad. It is very sad. Coming to Sufism, what I understand from Sufism, actually I am not historian, let me say this one, I am not historian, but I am fond of history, so I read a lot of books about history, and then when I came to India, I got lots of books about Hyderabad. One of them is The Great Turks in Hyderabad, written by a professor here. It was very wonderful, being a Turkish. That's why Sufism is a form of self-purification leading to inner dimension of Islamic rituals, a deeper understanding of the divine acts, and a greater knowledge and love of the divine. So I understand the Sufism from this perspective. So it is very highly alive and performed in Hyderabad. And another perspective of Sufism in terms of Turkish context, if we can think, we have the greatest Sufi poet from Turkey. He is Mevlana Celaleddin Rumi, and he was born in Balkh, today's Afghanistan, and through via Iran, he came to Syria. Later on, he settled down in Turkey. He lived in Turkey. He passed away in Turkey, and he He was a great Sufi poet. And of course, he's written his books in Persian language, because in those days, the official language was Persian. Even in the Turkish territory, like Seljuk empires, the official language was Persian. And then the state is Turkish, people are Turkish, but official language is the Persian. So there are lots of affection on Turkish society as well by Persian culture. We can say it is a mix of Persian and Turkish culture in today's Turkey. In those days, actually, it was very the gradually the changing. The territories were gradually changing. We cannot identify those regions who were ruling. And then once the Safavids came, Ottomans came, even some of the Turkish tribes, ethnicity there, they were Turkish, but they were following the Shia belief. So they are considered as a Persian, but actually they are Turkish, like Kulu Kutub Shah. Ethnicity there, they may be Turkish, because some historians told me that originally they are Turkish people, but they follow Shia belief. So it is difficult to identify, because the many the tribes came, many the other branch of Turkic civilization came, Persia came, Kurdish people lived once. So, but we can say it is a good fusion of the Sufism, Persian culture, Turkish culture in Hyderabad. So enjoying with Hyderabadi biryani, I would like to congratulate. And by the way, what we do as the India Dialogue Foundation, it is an international dialogue organization. We promote universal values, love, tolerance. We support social harmonies among the societies. So we also conduct the seminars, conferences. 3 years back, we conducted international conference on Indo-Turkish dialogue in University of Hyderabad. So from Turkey, Mevlana Celaleddin Rumi University participated. We came to know that the another the good point of Turkish and Telangana, Telangana relation is that language. Telugu language is a Dravidian language as the Turkish. So we come from the same family. Even one of the professors pointed that in Telugu, there is a verb. In English, it is called, you know, weeping. That the verb of the action of the weeping is called in Telugu, he said, chupar, something like that, chupar. In Turkish, we call super. So, and then he pointed lots of the common words between Telugu and Turkish. So once upon a time, we Turkish people were living in Central Asia. Later on, by the pressure of China, and we moved around the world. Some tribes reached to Europe, Attila Khan, and then he destroyed the Roman Empire, and then he changed the age. And then some tribe came to Turkey in 71, Alparslan reached Turkey. Some tribes reached to China and assimilated over there. Some tribes that came to India as well. Genetically, there is no any relationship between Telugu and Turkish people, but the language-wise, we are coming from the same family. So this is also a good sign for the relationship between Telugu and Turkish. I would like to mention this one before finishing my words. Thank you so much, and I appreciate this work, really. This kind of conferences are bonding the societies. I appreciate. Thank you so much, sir, giving the opportunities. Salam alaikum.
He himself was a mark of a lot of work and no words. So it's very difficult to introduce a person like him and then say a few words about him. In any case, I'll make an attempt. I wish I succeed. Professor S.M. Azizuddin Hussain, sir, is a Sir Syed Fellow. He was born on 29th December 1952. He now probably served Department of History, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi for quite a long time. His CV, which runs into about 35 pages, is a big challenge for me to present everything within a couple of minutes. It's difficult for me as well. And then if I don't do an elaborate exercise, I think it is not really introducing the guest properly. So I'm caught between a dilemma of introducing him completely or making an attempt. It's something like a student facing an essay question which he expected to be a short note. So difficult. But anyway, his educational qualifications are very, very impressive. It's anybody's dream. His high school, he did that at AMU Aligarh with the second division, again a pre-university course with the same university with the second division again. BA Honours History from the same university. I think except PhD, he has done everything possible academically from AMU only. And his PhD was from Jamia Millia Islamiyah, New Delhi, which he acquired way back in 1979. It's almost 30 years there and 20 here. It's almost 50 years ago. So his research experience spans 42 years. Teaching experience is as high as 37 years. The administrative experience is no less. It's about 16 years, as I get from this. He's got huge number of publications, which could be divided as per our norm, that books and research articles and seminar presentations and then editing and all the stuff. He has penned about 27 books. We started in 1982 till 2007, as I get from the facts from here. It's about 82 to 2017 is 1835 years of research experience that translated into 27 books published by various publishers. Papers published is 100 plus, 118. That's anybody's dream figure as far as research output is concerned. Then administrative experience is equally very impressive. Like, he held different positions, university to growing to the level of dream position like vice chancellor in a university setup, not anywhere else. And he has got book reviews also to his credit. It's about 9. He has published newspapers, about 14 papers. And reports of Raza Library, it's about 6 in number. I've got I'm getting lost in the whole maze of data I have on my hand. So, and papers presented in the national and the international seminars are 221. It is quite. Then Indian and foreign students awarded PhD degree under the supervision, that speaks about his research guidance and then the kind of students he had. The topics also vary. They actually take a journey from one end of the pendulum to the other, covering various aspects of history. He has successfully guided 17 PhDs. And then research projects are 193. It is a little disturbing in terms of number because one or two projects, people claim a lot of things, and then it's about 193. Now, I understand, if you permit me, the kind of load he has really shouldered, so look at him, and that's a problem. Anybody can understand. Yeah. So, and I think we all of us collectively are fortunate enough to have you with us this afternoon to deliver a memorial lecture of the master of administration, as I call him. This is my personal opinion. Nobody could disagree with this. Because I worked under him, I was recruited, and then that was the kind of image he has created in me as a person with about 34 years. I served in a college for about 10 years before joining this university in 94. So I think I have had the good fortune of working under him for a couple of years. Then I had my own faint image of how a person looks like and what he stands for. I tried probably to understand him, not to emulate him. But to me, he was a man of few words and only action and nothing else. And thank you very much, sir, for making it convenient to come down to this part of the country to deliver a lecture on a role model for most of the academics. And then in terms of administration, he was more than a role model. So I stand before you to do that exercise. I think I'm partially all right. Let me see. And memorial lectures of great personalities who made their own impeccable contribution to the development of any organization where they work, where they still associate after their retirement. I think last year onward, there has been a good tradition set up by the present Vice Chancellor, Professor Sitaram Rao, of probably consciously and then very, very highly calibrated exercise was carried out to identify people who made real contribution. So I don't mean to make any kind of an exercise in discounting the efforts put by others. I think he instituted a lot of memorial lectures, and one of those is the one on Bashiruddin, sir. So, and as I personally feel, organizing, then attending memorial lectures is actually a commitment we are giving to ourselves and to the institute to emulate the values established by the people and then carry their ideology and philosophy right from the foundation level to the point of finish with all commitment. If at least some of us made an attempt, it is an occasion for all of us to recall your association with him and recount the contribution he has made, but also an opportunity for us to commit ourselves to a better cause for which he stood for. So with those things, I think I request the Vice Chancellor to conduct the rest of the proceedings, and then I thank you very much. Thank you.
Professor K.S. Rao, Vice Chancellor, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Open University, Professor A. Sudhakar, Professor C. Venkatia, and friends. I am highly grateful to Professor K.S. Rao, Vice Chancellor Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Open University, Hyderabad, for giving me the honor of delivering Professor S. Bashiruddin Memorial Lecture. Tasawwuf is having 3 degrees. 1, period of quietest, period of development of Sufi philosophy from Ibn Arabi's Futuhat-e-Makkiya, Sheikh Shahabuddin Sohrawardi's Awariful Maarif, and Sheikh Ali Ujwairi's Kashful Mahjub. The last book on Sufism was compiled in India, in the city of Lahore. India has become an abode of Sufism. Sufism has become very popular in India. The third stage is of the organization of Sufi Silsilas. These Sufi Silsilas, Chishti, Sohrawardi, Kobravi, Firdausi, and some other Silsilas came to India. They divided the Delhi Sultanate into their Vilayat and worked there. Not only cities, but they also covered the Qasbas of northern India. No doubt Sufis also settled in Kerala also, but northern India during the period of Sultans of Delhi, their last town was Devgir, and that too was in a very fluctuating position. We find a progress in the frontier line of the Sufi movement in the south. Devgir was conquered by Sultan Alauddin Khilji, but he agreed on the payment of Kharaj by the Raja. Sometimes they used to stop payment of Kharaj. Successors of Alauddin Khilji faced crisis and could not make a firm policy relating to Deccan. Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq's attention remained focused on northwest frontier of India. When Muhammad bin Tughlaq became the Sultan of Delhi, he made a plan for Deccan. Muhammad bin Tughlaq realized the Sultans of Delhi could not control the Deccan because they failed to develop a Muslim pocket. For this reason, he had to choose Devgir. He developed a new town adjacent to Devgir and named that town as Daulatabad. He planned this town and built mosques, khanqahs, and houses. Earlier, Delhi Sultanate was having a cantonment in Devgir, and naturally cantonment has no role in the society of that region. After the fall of Baghdad in 1258 AD, migration of ulama and mashayikh had taken place to Delhi, because during 13th century, Delhi was considered as the safest capital of the Muslim world. Ulama and mashayikh came from Baghdad, Iran, and large number of towns of Central Asia devastated by Mongols. These ulama and mashayikh came and settled in Multan, Lahore, Panipat, Delhi, Badaun, Ajmer, Amroha, Radhauli, Kohl, and other towns. So Muhammad bin Tughlaq studied that Delhi and its adjoining towns are full of ulama and mashayikh. They worked there for a period of around 120 years and had a great impact of their khanqahs. They created a culture of harmony and peace. Muhammad bin Tughlaq thought that if some of these ulama and mashayikh are shifted to Daulatabad, so we shall achieve the same target which we have already achieved in northern India. So basically, Muhammad bin Tughlaq's idea was to develop a center of Islamic culture in Deccan. All the three contemporary scholars, Ziauddin Birni, author of Tariq-e-Firuzshahi, Isami, author of Futuh Salatin, and Ibn Battuta, author of Ajaibul Asfar, could not understand the objective of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, and even British historians and colonial Indian historians of modern period failed to understand the main objective of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. They declared it as transfer of capital, which we are still teaching to our students of history. There are reasons for the misconception created by his contemporary scholars like Birni, Isami, and Ibn Battuta. Birni's contradiction could be understood from the fact that he opines that all people of Delhi migrated to Daulatabad, but he forgets that he never left Delhi at all. Isami's interpretation is a biased statement, because his maternal grandfather was also ordered to leave Delhi for Daulatabad. He was an aged person and died after covering a distance of around 7 kilometers from Delhi, a town known as Tilpat. What was the sense of sending such an old person for this work? Ibn Battuta was not present at that time, so whatever he heard, he just recorded. Modern historians just copied all that evidence without examining that evidence. It was a good project, but was badly executed. Muhammad bin Tughlaq issued a coin from Deghbir, were inscribed as Qubba-e-Din, Badrul Islam, and Darul Islam. Amir Hasan Sizdi, Murid of Sheikh Nizamuddin Awliya and the compiler of his Malfuzat, Fawaidul Fuad, was also ordered to shift from Delhi to Daulatabad, said, Kujas Hazrat-e Delhi, wa khub roya nash, yake bahish darun, wa barun upur ho. Basic problem was that Sufis had the concept of spiritual vilayat, and this order of Muhammad bin Tughlaq was a challenge for them and the interference in their organization. Isami, who was deadly against this plan of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, got impressed the way Devgir emerged as a center of Islamic culture. Devgir had taken a life and hardness as corner. Due to the people of Delhi, Devgir has become full of life. Devgir is full of the air of heaven. Some Sufis died in Daulatabad, and their graves had taken the shape of holy places. So the whole environment has been changed. We see all the leading Sufi poets of Iran and Central Asia and other parts of Muslim world, like Maulana Jalaluddin Rumi, Hafiz Shirazi, Sheikh Sadi, Abdul Rahman Jami, Firdausi, Asadi, Nizami, Khayyam, and others, had already sang a new song of liberalism, humanity, Sulaykul, peace and prosperity. Sheikh Sadi said, Bani Adam Azai Yak Pekaran Kedar Afrinash Ze Yargo Yak Goran Cho Azwe Badard Avurd Rozgar Digar Azwaha Ra Namanat Karar. Those sons of Adam are limbs of each other, having been created of one essence. When the calamity of times afflicts one limb, the other limb cannot remain peaceful. When the British administrators built this Rashtrapati Bhavan, so in the Ashoka, in the collar of the dome of Ashoka Hall, they have inscribed these verses of Sadi. And when Dr. Abdul Kalam became the President of India and entered in the Ashoka Hall, so he asked his secretary, Professor Khan, that what is written on the collar of this hall? So he said, it is written in Persian, and I have no knowledge of Persian. So he told him that, no, you translate it tomorrow. So I want to know what is written. So Professor Khan called me in Rashtrapati Bhavan. I translated those couplets, and he gave those couplets to Dr. Kalam. So even Britishers have adopted these lines of Sheikh Sadi and inscribed in the Ashoka Hall's collar of the dome. I don't know how many members of parliament and ministers have seen this, these verses of Sheikh Sadi. Hafiz Shirazi said, غرض مسجد و میخانہ ہم وصال شما است جزین خیال ندارم خدا گواہ من است. Basically, by masjid or a bar, I want to meet you. God knows that apart from it, I don't have any thing other than this. مولانا عبد الرحمن جامی said, ہر جا سنم است محبت ما است یک قبل نماز ما ندارد. Wherever there is an idol, that is the place of worship for me. I don't have one direction of prayer. Sheikh Attar said, Hamaja talibe yaran che hushyar che mas, Hamaja khane ishqas che masjid che kanish. Everywhere people are seeking the friend, learned or the free man. Everywhere there is a house of love, whether it is a mosque or a temple. Amir Khusro said, Ek tana zibut ba hindu bari ham amos Azbe Parastish Gari, O you who snare at the adultery of a Hindu, learn also from him how the worship is done. Then again he says, Nis Hindu asse kadidare chuma, hasbase jaye baqarare chuma. Though Hindu is not faithful like me, he often believes in the same thing as I do. Bekasi Ghaznavi said, whether in the idol temple or in Kaaba, I look to none but thee. Sheikh Attar said, Chu Isa dar sukhan shiri zaba suno, sadafra shikan wa gohar fisha suno, be polite in conversation like Jesus and spread pearls from your heart. Jami said, Bandai ishudi tark nasab kun jami ke dari ra fala ibn fala chize nis. Jami, you have become the slave of love. And now, in this way, there is no question that you are the son of such and such. Rumi said, the religion of love is apart from all religions. The lovers of God have no religion but God alone. Urfi said, never say that Kaaba is better than temple. Any place having the splendor is better. Lover is basically a lover, whether a Muslim or a pagan. As Parvana makes no distinction between the lamps of mosque or a temple. Ghalib, a 19th century Persian and Urdu poet, said, Hum mubahid hain, hamara kesh hai, tarke rusum, millatein jab mit gayin, azzae ima ho gayin, highlighting the doctrine of unity of being and one creed is to renounce all formalities of faith and the different communities when obliterate became ingredients of my faith. Mir Anis and another 19th century Urdu Marsiya poet said, Har rang mein jalwa hai, teri khudrat ka, jis phool ko soongta hoon, boot ho rahi hai. Each flower bears the splendor of your fragrance. Whichever flower I smell, the fragrance is yours. Sheikh Nizamuddin Aulia said, Har qaum raast rahe, deene wa qubla gahe. For every people there is religion and direction to which they turn to pray. Sheikh Nizamuddin Awliya used to recite very often, he who is not my friend, may God be his friend, and he who bears ill will against me, may his joys increase. He who puts thorns in my way on account of enmity, may every flower that blossoms in the garden of his life be without thorns. The famous doctrine of Muhyiddin Ibn Arabi, Wahdatul Wujud, Unity of Being, was quite revolutionary doctrine as far as harmony between the followers of different religions is concerned. The doctrine of unity of being implied that entire mankind is one. It reflects the glory of God. It meant that essential being is one and we are manifesting of this being. Doctrine of Wahdatul Wujud also inculcates sense of unity among all human beings. It also inculcates deep respect for nature and other objects in the universe, as everything in the universe is the reflection of His glory. Ibn Arabi's verses have always fascinated the students of this thought. Khwaja Sayyid Muhammad Ghaisud Raz was assigned the vilayat of Deccan by Sheikh Nazaruddin Chiragh Dehli. Khwaja Ghaisud Raz proved to be Chiragh-e-Deccan. Three Sufis, Mir Sayyid Ali Hamdani of Kashmir, my ancestor, Sheikh Sharfuddin Yahya Maneri of Bihar, and Khwaja Sayyid Muhammad Ghaisud Raz of Deccan wrote Shara of Fususul Hikam, and in this way they popularized Sheikh Muhyiddin Arabi's thought in Kashmir, Bihar and Deccan. Sufi Khanqahs proved to be the centers of peace and conflict resolution, as Sheikh Nizamuddin Awliya had said, there is nafs and there is qalb. In every human being, nafs is the abode of mischief, strife and animosity. Qalb is the center of peace and goodwill and resignation. If a man opposes you under the influence of his nafs, you should meet him with qalb. The qalb will overpower the nafs and strife would end. But if a man oppress nafs with nafs, there can be no end to conflict and strife. In this way, they trained their khulafa and murids to work for peace in the society. On the eve of Timur's invasion, we find section of Sufis migrated from northern India to Sindh, which resulted in the richness of the culture of Deccan. From the end of 14th century, Burhanpur remained the center of Sufis of Chishti Silsila. Rulers of Deccan, like Sultan Ali Adil Shah I, had a devotion towards Sufis. All these factors proved helpful in the promotion of Sufi thought and ideas in the Deccan. In the socio-religious life of Deccan, Sheikh Burhanuddin Gharib, Sheikh Sayyid Zamiruddin Dawood, Sheikh Ainuddin Bijapuri, Khwaja Sayyid Muhammad Ghaisud Raz, and Sheikh Sirajuddin Junaidi played a significant role. Sufis looked upon social service as the supreme object of their spiritual exercises. It had its own impact on the people of Deccan. According to Sayyid Shah Khusro Hosseini, to quote, one of the most celebrated figure in the history of Sufism in Deccan was Khwaja Sayyid Muhammad Ghaisud Raz, who played conspicuous role in the Deccan. Hindus also frequently visited him and stayed in his khanqa without any inhibition, unquote. He also read Sanskrit books to know the mythology of Hindus. Sayyid Muhammad Ghaisud Raz's father, Sayyid Yusuf, composed Manan Suhagan Nama in Deccani. Khwaja Sayyid Muhammad Ghaisud Raz, Mehrajul Ashiqin, is a symbol of composite culture and social integration. Sayyid Muhammad Ghaisud Raz's most important work in the Deccani is the Mehrajul Ashiqin. He translated Sufi thought into Deccani so that the people of Deccan could understand it, because Sufis had no bias on language. His great peer Sheikh Fariduddin Ganshakar learned Punjabi and composed verses in Punjabi. So he translated Sufi thought in Punjabi poetry. Later on, his verses were included in Guru Granth Sahib, the holy book of Sikhs. Khwaja Ghaisud Raz's son, Khwaja Muhammad Akbar Hosseini, and his grandson, Khwaja Sayyid Abdullah Hosseini, also wrote books on Sufism. The rebellious attitude of Sufis created a pleasant atmosphere in Deccan, and their khanqahs have become the centers of cultural synthesis and communal harmony. Sufi poetry also became quite popular in Deccan, and the verses of Maulana Jalaluddin Rumi, Maulana Abdul Rahman Jami, Hafiz Shirazi, Sheikh Sadi found their abode in the hearts of the people of Deccan. So the Sufi poetry played a very constructive role. Sufi khanqahs were also having madarsas and kitab khanas, that is libraries. All the leading Sufis were having their own libraries in different vilayas of Deccan. Sufis of Deccan also wrote books on the basic thought of the tasawwuf, malfuzat of the Sufis, poetry, as well as the biographical account of the Sufis of Deccan. Today, the collection of manuscripts in Salar Jung Museum, Asfiya Library, Usmania University Library, and archives is a result of the dedication of ulama and Sufis of Deccan. They enrich the literature of Deccan. The other institution introduced by the Sufis was the Azadari of Imam Hussain in Deccan, which played a very constructive role in bringing people belonging to different religions, sect, and caste at one platform. Nature and character of Khanqahs and Ashur Khanas were same because both were founded by Sufis. Rawdatul Shuhada was translated into Deccani poetry by Seva of Gulbarga, Wali of Vellore, and Sayyid Ahmad Ali. Harun Khan Sherwani writes, to quote, "The stories connected with Muharram became part of Hindu folklore and were rendered into Telugu verses, Jang Namae Panjatane Pak and Marsiyas. Most of these songs are sung not only during the Muharram, but throughout the year by Telugu folks and vary from locality to locality," unquote. Recitation of these Marsiyas in Muharram, in which all can share, is suited more to countryside. The earliest known Marsiya in the Deccani dialect was composed by Burhanuddin Janam, the son of famous Bijapuri Sufi belonging to Qadriya Chishtiya Silsila Shah Miran Shamsul Haq, Shamsul Ushaq. Both father and the son were outstanding Sufi writers and poets. They composed Sufi treatises and poems in Persian and Urdu. Janam's Marsiyas depicts the pouring out of divine love through the heart felt sorrow for Imam Hussein's martyrdom. Ibrahim Adil Shah's second's court poet Nuri wrote Marsiyas in Deccani dialect. Ali Adil Shah was a poet and composed Marsiyas. Nawazish Ali Khan composed a masnavi called Rawdatul Athar on the tragedy of Karbala. The Marsiya by Shah Quli Khan Shahi of Golconda aroused interest in the Urdu forms in Delhi and other Indian towns and helped to promote the art in northern India. These Marsiyas helped in bringing people together on one platform belonging to any religion, sect, or caste. The Sufis promoted communal harmony with their devoted activities and attracted the caste-ridden and oppressed lower sections to the organization fold. Titus rightly said, to quote, "It was through Sufism that Islam really found a point of contact with Hinduism, an effective entrance to Hindu heart," unquote. R.K. Meg holds opinion, to quote, "We can thus conclude that whenever there is a crisis of cultural identity or the romantic spirit is restricted, the Sufi heritage would speak with thousand tongues to us all," unquote. The Sufis have never been sectarian because they never identified with any particular sect. All the Sufi poets had condemned communal hatred and religious bigotry and preached communal harmony and social integration. Sufis stood for cultural coexistence. Sufi idea of cultural coexistence became the norm of mutual relations during medieval period in Deccan. This is the great legacy which Sufis have left for the succeeding generations in Deccan. Respect for cultural diversity is perhaps the great contribution of Sufis to Indian civilization. Today, when we are facing a great challenge from the communal and divisive forces bent upon promoting conflict in the name of creed, sect, caste, region, it is necessary to divide the spirit of Sufis and Bhaks. The real spiritualists can always play a vital role in the creation of a better understanding, peaceful and normal living, and spiritual evolution in a pluralistic society. For every sane and genuine human being always works for sanity, organization of and loving participation in human society, and help to make genuine, authentic, and ultimately creative and spiritually energetic society. We need them again. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, sir. Thanks a lot for your elaborate and detailed account of impact of Sufi Zaman Dakkan. Really, as per the tradition, no one should speak after endowment lecture. But after listening to you, as a president of this session, I would take liberty to say a few observations of my own. Sir, you have covered a lot, but some of the, as you have said in your lecture, Jalaluddin Rumi said, the religion of love is apart from all religions. The lovers of God have no religion but God alone. It's one of the great saying. It is applicable to everything, sir. So, almost the same thing says in Visishtadvaita also. Ramanuja's Visishtadvaita also this propagate the same type of ideas. One more thing. Basically, this I will say later. Then, one more important thing what I have observed is, it was through Sufism and that Islam really found a point of contact with Hinduism and effective entrance into Hindu's heart. This fact, 100%, this is a reality. And these are the great observations made by you. Definitely will help us to take up a serious research on Sufi saints and Sufi poets in the Dakkan region. Next, I think the history department should think on these lines, how best we can revive the philosophy of Sufism and their relevance to the present context, where we are unnecessarily fighting on religious identities and caste identities and cultural identities. Bekar, waste hai, pura. So, to eradicate that, we have to do this. Then one more thing I wanted to say, I wanted to know from you about Khalil Gibran. Khalil Gibran was a great poet who wrote Prophet. I think, did he have any impact of Sufism on his writings? Whether he belongs to Sufi philosophical tradition or not? No? So he wrote many things like this in his Prophet also. Then one more thing I have reminded, I reminded of one song of very old Hindi cinema where Raj Kapoor acted in this, Main Nashe Mein Hoon. It's by a couplet, I suppose. Before that song, start with a small Urdu couplet. Jahed sharab peene de, masjid mein bait kar. Ya wo jagah bata de, mujhe jahan par khuda na ho. It's very wonderful. I don't know how do you take this, but the where God is there everywhere, but in even masjid also, when you cannot say that you cannot allow him to sit in masjid and drink, and the same thing it is there in this, whether it is bar or temple, basically by masjid or bar, I want to meet you, meet the God. God knows that apart from, if I don't have anything other than this. So these are the great observations, really inspired us to think very seriously on the basic cultural values of the Sufism and Sufist philosophical tradition. So culture, in my opinion, culture is like a flowing river. And it is a dynamic phenomenon in the society, in civilization. It is not a static one. So culture will go on assimilating various factors of life of human beings and also lifestyles of human beings. This is my opinion, sir. Thank you once again. Thanks a lot for your great lecture on Sufi impact of Sufism on Dakkan. And we will go for the next item on the agenda. Now there is felicitations to our guest speaker today. I request PRO to conduct this program, and then followed by vote of thanks.
Professor Basirjan Memorial Lecture. My colleague Professor Sudhakar, Director Academic, and the keynote speaker of today's function, Professor S.M. Majiduddin Hussain, former Head Department of History, Jamia Millia Islamia University, New Delhi. And ladies and gentlemen, I feel it my pleasant duty to propose vote of thanks on the occasion of the memorial lecture on Professor Syed Bashiruddin Sahab, the former Vice Chancellor of our university. We all know that Professor Bashiruddin was a great teacher, par excellence, besides being one of the pioneers of communication and journalism education in the country. He was a professor and head department of communication and journalism, Usmani University. And he was also Indian ambassador to Qatar. He was the fourth vice chancellor of this university. Thus, he held many positions in his lifetime. In fact, we are fortunate enough to have him as vice chancellor of this university, who was instrumental for creation of many assets. And on this occasion, I thank our vice chancellor, Professor Sitaram Rao Garu, for organizing the lecture in his memory. This is the second one in the series of memorial lectures on behalf of Professor Bashiruddin Sahab. And after taking charge as the vice chancellor, he is organizing series of memorial lectures, and this is second one. And this is also an occasion for us to remember the great personality, Professor Bashiruddin. And we all know that we are here in the Jubilee Hills. I think prior to that, we were there at Somaj Guda. He was instrumental for construction of this building, academic building and administrative building. And was also instrumental for shifting this university from Somaj Guda to Jubilee Hills. And it is also an occasion for remembering his efforts, not only in construction of these buildings, academic and administrative buildings, and an auditorium with a capacity of 600 seating, a study material house, a guest house, a library building, and creation of positions like rector position, director CSTD, development officer, women development and extension center, SAST cell, setting up of regional study centers. We have 23 regional study centers spread across both the states of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, and creation of campus development fund, and adoption of pension rules for the teachers, and construction of providing multi-purpose mobile laboratory and plantation on the campus, and getting many sanctions of teaching and non-teaching positions to this university. So because of that, this is occasion to remember the great personality, Professor Bashiruddin Sahab. And in this connection, Professor, we have invited Professor Azizuddin Hussain Sahab. Really, for the first time, I came to know what constitutes the Sufism. This is also an occasion and opportunity for me to learn the ideals of Sufism. And in fact, in the morning, when this is the lecture today, anyhow, I am going to speak. I don't know what to speak on this occasion about Sufism. So I was just listening to the video And then my friend, colleague, Sudhakar called me, where are you? So immediately I just put off that lecture and came here. And really this Sufism, I think I can say that which is based on the reason, and within the framework of the Islam. This is what I can guess. It is a combination of many religions. I was also listening to the the role of Moses, the role of Moses in Sufism also, here and there, and the role of many other religions. The best ideals of religions have taken to form into a different cult called the Sufism. This what I feel. And within a short span of period, our chief guest of today's function has gave us the best example within a short form in his lecture. And there I came to know that the religion of love is apart from all religions. The love of God have no religion but God alone. These are some of the classic examples where we are supposed to live in a friendly and brotherhood manner. And we all know that when we are living this world, the eternal world, we are not taking anything with us. We are supposed to leave everything here and go to the, we don't know whether we are going to the heaven or hell. I don't know whether that is there or not. But the thing is, ultimately what we are living the good or bad. These are the two things that can guide the principles of human brotherhood. And that is, I think, that is the main aim, main idea behind Sufism. Sufism is revolves around the human brotherhood. This what I guess from the Sufism.
Universal
fraternity, universal brotherhood. So religion, I think, if we call it a religion, it revolves around these three or four things. And if that is a fact, we are supposed to, it is also occasion for us to convert ourselves to Sufism. This is the best thing where, after going through the words of mentioned in this keynote address, there are many, taking two or three things from this speech. I think this is what we are supposed to practice from tomorrow onwards. Sir, I feel this is a really great opportunity for us to know what constitutes Sufism. And also, I thank our Vice Chancellor for creating an opportunity by way of organizing memorial lecture, culminating the Deccan History Society, and with the efforts of both Deccan History Society and Department of History. I thank our chief guest of today's function and all the dignitaries and participants present here for coming and participating in this memorial lecture. I also thank my PRO for putting all his efforts for bringing out a booklet on this occasion and also organizing. I thank also the engineering branch, all the AVPRC branch for covering the proceedings of this memorial lecture. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.